Where you guys been? We've been missing you. This is, they don't sound real thrilled, do they? I told Danny, I know what it feels like to be in a Western getting held up at a bank. All the people out here with these masks. You guys make us a little nervous. No, we're glad you all are here. We're excited. We've missed you all. I know you guys have missed being here. Welcome to our folks that are on Facebook Live. We've got folks, and it's been an awesome opportunity to just spread the gospel. And in this thing, you get on Facebook at any point in time on Sundays, and there are church services after church services. And we were talking about it one day. This is not something that has been put lightly, because God's using this as an opportunity to spread the gospel across the world. So this is a fantastic thing. We're excited you guys are back. We're going to start our song service this morning with "I'll Fly Away." So if you'll stand with us, please. "I'll Fly Away."
Decorations. I'm telling you, there have been a lot of hard work, and I'm And I'm just proud to know that, you know, I'm part of a church that's stuck together during this time, and that now we're ready to worship, and we got through this. And I know it ain't over, but for me, seeing y'all in this church is over. You know what I'm saying? It's time to go. We had it prepared that if we got over 170 that we would go to the overflow area, but we're good. I think people are going to start trickling in as people, you know, feel a little bit more comfortable. But I'm going to call out a couple of people today. First of all, I'm going to call out Mr. Harrell and Ms. Barbara. It's been since January, the end of January, since they've been able to come to church. Isn't that great to see them there this morning? You want to talk. Now, wait a minute. I don't know what's up in a word now. This probably wants to talk.
Well, y'all know what he went through. And we have been so absolutely blessed by our church family and our families and the prayer. Honey, I wasn't a bit afraid. I knew he was going to be right. I knew that he was going to be okay one way or the other. I didn't want something to happen to me, but I knew he'd be fine. Oh boy, I still have him, thank God. Amen. And everybody that came, everybody that called, the cars, oh my lands, the people that came to the church, listen to me, that came to the hospital, you know, when he was there. I am so, so happy for the child came and the prayers, Lord, mercy. You know, it was an absolute blessing before, during, and after. So I thank every one of you, my family.
Thank you, Ms. Barbara. By the way, that is the least words I ever heard Ms. Barbara say in her life. So, since I'm on. There was a lot of amen on that. Did you hear that? Oh, and if we was going to bring a prize out today, we would bring out the one who brought the most. Y'all take a look at the sound booth back there. Look at that line of people back there. Goodness gracious. Greg and Tiffany and I brought the whole neighborhood. Thank you, Greg and Tiffany, for bringing that. By the way, look back there. Continue to look back there. Don't look at Greg and Tiffany this time. But look at the sound booth. It's been extended. There's been hard work on that.
It's tech bunker.
Tech bunker. For the military man, let's make sure we get it right. Tech bunker.
That's so expanded. You got to call what he names it.
Anyway, we're glad to have y'all this morning. We're excited. Just expect in the coming weeks, we don't know how things are going to change. If things change, we have to change. But let me tell you something. I believe that our church was so faithful and we worked so hard. I believe that we've done everything that we possibly could to make this as safe as possible for you. And I'm excited for it. Thank you all for your hard work. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for anybody out there listening that's not able to come to the service this morning. We appreciate what you have done and how you've been watching. And that if you're not here today and you're not comfortable, we're not judging you for it. We'll wait till you feel comfortable, and we're glad that you're joining us on Facebook Live. All right, so let's go ahead and go with a word of prayer. I can talk all day. I'm not even preaching yet. Let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for today. Thank you so much, Lord. It's kind of like a monumental moment, Lord, that we get to come back into your house and worship you. Thank you so much, Lord, for those ones that have been faithful. And thank you, Lord, for this church. Thank you, Lord, for just your grace and your mercy that you have shown us, for your protection that you have shown us. And I just pray, dear God, that you would just help us, Lord, right now to worship you in spirit and truth, to understand that this is an exciting time, not to be down or complaining about wearing a mask or any other thing we have to do during this time. Just be happy and joyful that we get to praise the Lord today in person. Thank you so much for that. And I pray, dear God, that you would just be with every part of the service. Lord, may you be glorified in it all. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Yeah. If you'll stand with us, please, our next song this morning is How Great the Father's Love for Us. The open G. I'll let you get through there, Amy. Here we go.
Yeah.
is not uncommon of me. Our next song this morning, since you just sat down, we're going to make you stand right back up. You can't sit down on this one, so you guys got to be stretching, you know, you better. You got to get some time to get up and down. This is how great is our God, and He's going to lead us.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord.
Cool. Fantastic. Is there special music this morning? It's going to be Brother Danny and the Misfits. So, Brother Danny, this song is beautiful. I mean, just an absolutely beautiful song. It's called Faithfulness.
Anybody know sign language? I need somebody up here to do sign language to tell them to look like Andy. I didn't turn my microphone off until I said that.
Now I'll be through. All right. Turn to Isaiah chapter 44 with me this morning. I do want to let you know you didn't see the offering plate being passed around. There is offering buckets over here at this door and at the back entrance. So if you don't give online, always know that you can give online now. But if you don't give online and you want to drop your offerings there, drop it on the way out. And also at the end of the service, we're going to be dismissed by Rose. Mitch will be in the front, dismissing Rose in the front. And we're going to wait until that Rose gets out. And then Craig will be in the back, and he's going to dismiss the rows in the back. And just kind of follow suit, you know, just so we can be safe and do the right thing. Also, our Wednesday night service will be planned for 6:30. Okay, 6:30 as usual on Wednesday night. And we'll have it here too. Okay. All right, so Isaiah chapter 44. We're continuing this sermon on Isaiah 41 and beyond. And I know you've been faithful. I know a lot of you've been listening to it online, and I appreciate it. And I tell you what, this is going to be a hard sermon to preach today because most of you, I can't see your faces, so I can't tell whether you're smiling or you're growling or what. But I'm just going to imagine that you're smiling, you know, right? Lania, you only have a mask on and you're not smiling. Where's that? That's better, all right. You know I'll call you out. Isaiah 44. Oh, by the way, and you want to talk about somebody that's been missing people? That's been Daryl. Man, Daryl, look, he was supposed to be an usher today, and we have people backed up at the door, and I look, and Daryl's in there talking. He can't stop talking long enough to usher people in. You missed some people, didn't you, Daryl? Isaiah chapter 44. We're going to talk about full of joy or fully ashamed. And that's what I want to go back to today, go back to Isaiah. And David, I want you to think about David. David, when he was full of joy, when the ark came back from being captured by the Philistines, and all of a sudden that ark was going to be brought back into Jerusalem, and David danced with joy. He was so excited because he had that joy in his life. But you know, it wouldn't be long that David would be fully ashamed with his affair with Bathsheba. So that's the kind of thing I want you to look at. I'm going to go through a few more examples. But I want you to understand that even in the life of a Christian, we can feel like we're full of joy. And we're full of joy when we're doing the right thing. You see, when the Ark of the Covenant come back in, that was God's presence. And when you're in God's presence, you can't help but to dance with joy. If you're out there today, you can't help but to be happy and smiling because you're in the Lord's house today. That's being in the presence of the Lord, being able to worship God among other believers. That's that joy. But what happens in the life of a believer, and don't think that it doesn't happen in the life of Christians, is that sometimes you're going to get fully ashamed. If you're never fully ashamed as a Christian, you really don't know what it means to live for God. Hey, guess what? Y'all not on Facebook Live anymore. Y'all got to go. We need to be taught again out of amen in here.
Amen.
All right, that's a little better. Now think about this. What happens in the life of a Christian? How many of y'all have been there? We got people that are watching out there on Facebook Live. They might not see you, but I can tell you one thing. I'll tell on you if they don't see you. But I want you to know how many of you out there felt like, man, I blew it. Come on, anybody? I've been there. Well, they're ashamed. Blew it. Felt like you just blew it with your family. Felt like you blew it with your friends. Felt like you blew it with your church. But most of all, you felt like you blew it with God. You know what that feels like? That's what I want you to know today. Sometimes we're full of joy. And the one thing about coming back into this house today, I knew what was going to happen when we come back into this house today. There was going to be joy. You can't help but to be around other believers and have that joy in your heart. And that's what I want to tell you, though, but sometimes we want to be the Lone Ranger. Sometimes we get over and isolate ourselves and get by ourselves and get behind closed doors, and that's when we want to do things that we know we're not supposed to do. And at those times, we get fully ashamed of who we are. You should be fully ashamed. There should be times in your life as a Christian to where you're fully ashamed. There should be times in your Christian, it should be more than off not. It should be every week that we're fully ashamed that we've done something every week. And you sin every day? Everybody want to agree with that? Yeah, you done something this morning that was probably pretty stupid? Well, that's exactly what it is. When you know that you have messed up in front of God, we need to be fully ashamed of that. How about Peter? Peter was full of joy when he was walking on that water. Who wouldn't be full of joy when you see Jesus Christ on the water and you come bebopping out there with him and you're not sinking? Who wouldn't be full of joy in that situation? Then all of a sudden, it wasn't long. Later on, Peter denied Jesus three times. He was full of joy, walked on water, and then when somebody asked, hey, you were with that Jesus fella, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know that Jesus. You see what I'm saying now? And Peter was fully ashamed of what he had done. It's in the life of every believer that it happens. That you just need to know and recognize that you're going to fully ashamed God sometimes. You're just going to be fully ashamed in front of God. And you know what? We can go on with examples. I will use one more example. Let's go through the example of Moses. Moses, when the Israelites were led, when he led them out of captivity, for 400 years the Israelites were in slavery, he led them out. Let me tell you something. The Bible maybe don't speak of this. What kind of joy would you feel if God used you to lead the Israelites out of slavery for 400 years? You know that man was on a spiritual high. He was happy. He was full of joy. But then all of a sudden, when Moses is leading them through the wilderness, pride gets in his way. Instead of speaking to the rock so water would come forth, he strikes the rock, and all of a sudden he's fully ashamed in front of God. You know what I love about the Bible? That it's not a bunch of people that are just faithful all the time without failures. Thank God that the Bible is there, and it's got people who have failed and messed up over and over again. That's where I belong, is knowing that I have messed up, knowing that I'm fully ashamed in front of God, knowing that I need to hit my knees more often and say, God, I'm a failure. I mess up. I don't deserve your grace, and thank you so much for giving it to me. That's what we want to talk about today, is either having that full of joy or being fully ashamed. Now, in chapter 44, in verses 1 through 20, I'm just going to kind of give you a little overview. God chose the people of Israel, and he redeemed them, but he also formed them for himself. In this chapter, Isaiah contrasts God's forming of Israel with the Gentiles forming their own God. In other words, here's the one true God, and then you got the Gentiles, whose people are not Israelites and Jewish. They're forming their own God. Now, before we get into all that, I want you to know this. When I talk about idols or false gods today, I don't want you to think that you're exempt from this service. That you say, well, that was just them putting an idol and making something of clay and putting it up there, or of gold, and then they worship that. Let's just define these things today. Before we even get into the message, let's define these things today. An idol should be anything that you put ahead of God. Now let me tell you something. I believe with all my heart, I can't tell you exactly why God allowed this pandemic, but I can tell you some things that could happen because of this pandemic. If you didn't learn anything during this time that God slowed you down, then you're not being faithful to God. And all of a sudden, you've got some idols in your life that you need to get rid of. You know what? I'm going to name one right off the bat. Somebody's not going to like it in here, but you're going to deal with it. Work. Somebody's got work as an idol in here. That means that you work too many hours of the day, and you can't stay home long enough to be with your family. Work is an idol in your life. Got it? Hobby. Right? Whether it's golf or shopping or whatever your hobby is, that you spend more time than you do with God, or you spend more time than you do with your family because of this idol that's in your life. You get where I'm going now? We got work and we got hobbies and things like that to take up your time. I'm going to throw one out to you that'll blow your mind. Ready? Your family. You say, wow. Well, aren't we supposed to spend time with our family? Absolutely. But you're not supposed to put your family ahead of God. Right. And what happens today is that we get so busy with all our kids doing everything in the world and we're running like chickens with our heads cut off. We ain't got time to worship with God. We're doing everything for them, but teaching them how to slow down and listen to God. If you're out there today and you heard any of these, don't think you're alone. Don't think I pointed fingers at anybody in here, because everybody in here belongs in that category somewhere. And if it's not the hobbies, it's not the work, and it's not your children or whatever else, throw something else in there that's an idol. You got me? How many of y'all can agree with that? That there's an idol in your life that you're putting ahead of God. And that's what we're going at today. Isaiah chapter 44, and look at verse 1. He says, "Yet hear now, O Jacob, my servant." Matter of fact, we haven't done this in a while, have we? There you go, Bill. That's exactly where I was going with that. Would you stand for the reading of God's Word? Isaiah chapter 44, and we'll read verses 1 through, I don't know how far we're going yet. We're going to go through verse 7. How about that? Says, chapter 44, verse 1. "Yet hear, O now, O Jacob, my servant, and Israel whom I have chosen. Thus says the Lord, who made you and formed you from the womb, whom will help you. Fear not, O Jacob, my servant, and you, Jerusalem, whom I have chosen. For I will pour water on him who is thirsty, and blood on the dry ground. I will pour out my spirit on your descendants, and my blessing on your offspring. They will spring out among the grass like willows by the watercourses. One will say, I am the Lord's. Another will say, will call himself by the name of Jacob. Another will write with his hand, the Lord's, and name himself by the name of Israel. Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first and the last. Besides me there is no God. And whom can I proclaim as I do? Then let him declare it and set it in order for me. Since I appointed the ancient people and the things that are coming and shall come, let them show these to them." May God bless the reading of His Word, and let us pray. Heavenly Father, I just pray, dear God, that you will speak in and through me. Thank you, Lord, for your Word today. And I pray, dear God, that you will keep me from error, that you will hide me behind the cross, and that all the things that are done here today will glorify you. Thank you again for letting us be in your house to worship you in person today. Thank you for those who are listening on Facebook Live. And we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're still dealing with some technical, just kind of bear with it. We'll get all this worked out. If I have to, I'll grab the microphone. Tell me, Sean, when you think I'll grab a microphone, I'll grab one. So what we're talking about, first of all, the first point I want to make is this. I want to go through a few things that will cause you to be full of joy, some things that will cause you to be fully ashamed. The first one I want you to know is this. Full of joy. Go to the mic. You want me to keep it on? All right. Keep preaching while Sean's over here messing with you. All right. All right, so here we go. So full of joy because you belong to the Lord. Now, listen to this. The time will come when Israel will be proud of belonging to God. You see, they're about to go through a mess. They're about to go through captivity and all this other stuff. And right now, but here's the time where Israel will come to be proud that they belong to God. If we are truly God, we should be unashamed. We should be unashamed and delighted to let everybody know about our relationship with Him. If you're one of those people that are walking around and you're scared to name that you're a Christian, it's probably because somewhere along the way Christians have ruined that name somewhere. But let me tell you something, it's up to you to bring that name of Christ to a good name. That means that you do the right thing, and people look at you and they see, and that you're proud to be a Christian, but you're not this arrogant Christian. And we'll go through all that in just a few minutes. Stephen Curry, of the NBA Golden State Warriors, is considered by some the greatest shooter in the history of the league. But his road to stardom, however, was not without trials. And he credits his faith in Jesus for keeping him going when a string of injuries hit him early in his career. He said, "I fell in love with the game really early. I played other sports, but basketball held a place, special place in my heart." He explained in an Act of Faith interview prior to winning his first NBA championship in 2015. To Curry, however, what he does on the basketball court is simply an extension of his faith in God, which first became personal when he was in middle school. Being saved is a great feeling. My relationship with Christ started around middle school. My parents had us in church every Sunday, every Wednesday. It was more of a tradition than a point, he explained. I didn't have a personal relationship with the Lord until one altar call Sunday. The youth pastor told us we needed to make a decision for ourselves and we couldn't rely on our parents. It had to be a decision on our own, and that's when I made it. There are so many things that we had to overcome in this life of Jesus. His work on the cross, he's paid the ultimate price for us, and this is what he says. Now, as some consider the best shooter in the league, and maybe ever, here's what he says. He says, I'm proud to be a child of God. I'm not going to read the rest of that article, but he says, I'm proud to be a child of God. I'm proud to be a child of God. I want you to know this today. How many of you are proud to be a child of God? Amen. That is nothing that we should be ashamed of. It's something that we should be happy of. It's something that should be on every person's face, is the joy of Jesus Christ. You can't be no happier than what Jesus Christ has done for you. You can't be no happier. You should be smiling a lot. You should be joking around a lot. You should be having the time of your life. Because we've got the best thing in the world. We got the best Savior in the world. We got the only Savior in the world. We got the only God in the world. And he calls me a son. You hear that? I'm a son of God. That is something to be proud of, people. You are a son or a daughter of God. That is no light statement there. That is to know that I'm proud to know my God. I'm proud to serve my God. I'm proud to be in front of other people that are watching on live to know that I'm proud to be a child of God. The second thing is this, fully ashamed because you put your trust in idols. Look at chapter 44, verse 8. It says, do not fear, do not be afraid. Have I not told you from that time and declared it? You are my witnesses. If there is a God beside me, indeed there is no other rock. I know not one. Those who make an image, all of them are useless. And their precious things shall not profit. They are their own witnesses. They neither see nor know that they may be ashamed. Now listen to this. The manufactured idols were guilty of false advertising. You see, they made these promises, but actually they were worthless and helpless. In God's contrast, God fulfills and he delivers on his promises. I want you to think about the false promises that idols do in your life today. I want you to think about what those idols that I mentioned and the idols that you put and fill in the blank with those idols. I want you to think that there's promises from Satan. It's not from God. It's these things that you put ahead of God. And he's saying this. These idols are promising you things that's not there. They're promising you fulfillment in life. Oh, if you chase these dreams and you chase your hobbies and you chase all these things and you work all this overtime and all this money, that you're going to have all this great success and you're going to be happy and all that. Do you ever see the richest people out in the world? They're not the happiest people in the world, are they? If you ever know it, it's the poorest people in the world that are the happiest. And y'all know that for sure, don't you, Bruce and Danny? And the poorest people in the world are the happiest. Those are the ones that praise God more. They're the ones that say that, hey, I don't need all this stuff. So when it comes down to idols, and these idols are promising you things that it's not going to deliver, we need to get rid of them. We need to, don't get rid of the kids now, you can't do that. Alright? But get rid of those things and just push them. You can't get rid of your job, either problem. But push away all that stuff that's just cluttering up your life. Cluttering up your time. You know what I see in my neighborhood? I see people walking down the road more. That's a praise. Let me tell you something. I'm talking about families walking down the road. And I didn't see that before this happened. Now all of a sudden I'm hearing children out in the yard playing more than ever. I'm hearing laughter. I'm hearing all this noise. It's a great feeling to know that people are actually spending family time together. I always say that there's some places in Savannah that's got some of the most beautiful houses, especially if you go down on the marsh. They got these beautiful views, and you just be amazed at these beautiful places. But you know what I always noticed when I rode through those neighborhoods like that? I never seen anybody on their porch. I never see anybody just sitting out there enjoying this beautiful place that they got. I'm thinking to myself, man, if I had a view like they had, I'd be out there every evening. Matter of fact, now I got a view like that, I'm out there every evening. All right? But I'm telling you right now that people don't spend enough time on their porches with their families and spending that quality time together because these idols have lied to you. And they lied to the people that was of this time, that they lied to them that they was going to produce something that was not going to be there. And when we keep falling into these lies and these traps, we're going to find out that it's nothing. When we share our faith with those who can find no meaning in life or have no hope in eternal life, we're not proclaiming anything that's unreliable. We're not proclaiming anything, and that's what the world sees. What happens is that you're telling people that, hey, I've got a Savior that can save you from your sin, and it's going to bring joy in your life. And then all of a sudden they see you at work and you're kicking rocks with your head down, and all of a sudden you're a miserable person. They're not going to believe you. They're not going to believe you. They're going to think that's shoddy, that there's something wrong with that, that there's a lie that you got in there. When Jesus Christ comes into your life, what we got to show is that now it has transformed my life. It has transformed my life. Now, I'm going to tell you something right now. There's some people in here right now, and I know there's one. I won't call him out, but I'm going to tell you right now. When he tells his testimony, guess what happens? Cries. And it ain't Danny, by the way. But he cries. You know what that means to me? That means that he knows what the Lord has done for him, and because he belongs to this great Savior, that he's a child of God, that he's proud of it, and he knows the things that he has done, and he's showing the world that it makes a difference to believe in Jesus Christ. You know what? I'm going to tell you right now, this is one of those things I shouldn't cross this line, and I bet some people are going to cringe when I cross it. I can't stop it. Lanny said to come on, so if it offends you, it's Lanny's fault. When we get on there, and I may have talked about it in my devotion sometimes online, but when I talk about hearing these things that Christians do online, when the governor starts to talk, Christians, you're not doing the right thing. I'm just going to tell you right now. If you're not going to like it, I'm just telling you right now, when you're sitting there dogging somebody in public and trying to disgrace their name, you want to say it in your house, that's probably not okay, but it's better than doing it online. You hear me? When you're sitting there posting stuff online, I'm not telling anybody. I haven't seen none of your names, thank God, so I can't point any fingers. But I'm just telling you, Christians are calling our governor bad names online. Some of you just don't like that. But you're going to get over it. But I'm going to tell you right now, it's not right. In a Christian's life, we're not supposed to shame anybody like that. We're not supposed to sit there and call them out in front of all those people. We need to be careful as Christians that we love on people. And we have lost that out of our lives. And if people want to see Christ in our lives, we're going to have to show that we are people who love God and love others. You got me? Yeah, you hear all the static. I know Satan's trying to disrupt this. That's okay. He's not going to get it out. I'll throw this thing off and we'll hear it. But I'm telling you right now, love on people. Love on even your government and people you don't agree with. And show people the world that Christians are different. You get me? You with me? You with me? You growling or you either snarling or something. I don't know. But I'm telling you right now that it's a difference in our life when we start treating people different. And so, when we're fully ashamed because we put our trust in God, do we make our own gods? We make money, fame, power? If we make a god of our choosing, we're deceiving ourselves if we expect to empower our lives? But think about this. Think about what goes on when we are fully ashamed. Now, you ready? Listen to this real quick. When we're fully ashamed, and you walk around fully ashamed and you don't confess this up to God and you don't repent of these sins, you know what we're doing? We're ruining our testimony. I'm telling you right now. You know what? You don't see somebody full of joy. Ready? You do not see somebody full of joy with a smile on their face and living in sin. You see people who are defeated. Christians who are defeated. Who have been brought down to their knees because you've been living in sin. And you're fully ashamed. You're fully ashamed of God, and you know what? You can't stand up here and say, that, hey, you know what? I'm a follower of God. I'm proud to be a follower of God. When you start living your life right, and you start living for God, you don't care who knows it. Y'all with me out there? Number three, full of joy because you serve the Lord. We're going to skip through some of this. Look at verse chapter 44, verse 21. Remember these, O Jacob and Israel, for you are my servant. I have formed you. You are my servant. O Israel, you will not be forgotten by me. God said that we should serve our Creator. Idolaters do the opposite, serving or worshiping what they have made rather than the one that God made. You see, our Creator paid the price to set us free from our sins against Him. But by contrast, no idol ever created, any idol, can redeem us from our sins. To know that I have joy because I can serve the Lord. The Lord said, I want you that we should serve our Creator. Ready? I bet you if I ask this question, don't raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. Please don't raise your hand. But if I ask this question out here today, how many of you would be able to say, I serve the Lord with all I have? Now, you can't say probably I serve the Lord 100%. I'm going to ask you another question. Can you say I serve God with 75% of my being and my energy? Can you say I serve the Lord with 50%? Can you say I serve the Lord with 25%? Let me tell you something. It's all or nothing with God. You either all in or back up. All in. This is what God wants of you. All in. Get it? You poker players out there, you better not be. You're not supposed to be playing poker. All in, throw all your chips in there. You say, I'm a pastor, I'm not supposed to know that. I watch TV. Alright, all in. Put it all in. Say, you know what? I bet all this on God. I bet all this that I'm going to serve God with all my heart and I'm going to serve Him for the rest of my life. And what happens is that we get tired. And we get down. And we retire. Anybody out there old enough to say, I retire from ministry? You can't retire from ministry. It ain't time for you to retire. It's time for us to get started. So, fully ashamed. Next one is fully ashamed because you believe in false idols. You believe in these things. Verse 25 says this. It says, who frustrates the sign of the babbler and drives the diviners mad? Who turns wise men backwards and makes their knowledge foolishness? Who confirms the word of his servant and performs the counsel of his messenger? Who says to Jerusalem, you shall be inhabited? To the cities of Judah, you shall be built, and I will rise up her waste places. Who says to the deep, be dry, and I will dry up your rivers? Who says to Sirius, he is my shepherd, and he shall perform all my pleasure, saying to Jerusalem, you shall be built, and the temple of your foundation shall be laid? The babblers were false prophets who claimed to bring messages from God. And these fortune tellers were people who created fake omens for their own belief, because God is the truth, the standard for all teaching. Do you believe that God is the truth today? You know what? I'm gonna camp out on that one for a moment. Do you believe that God is true today? Do you know that you don't have to fear anything that's going on right now in this world? You say God is the ultimate God, He's in charge of everything. You don't have to fear anything. I didn't say you didn't have to use common sense. You got to use your own judgment and do the right thing according to, you know, as we're told. But you don't have to be scared. Fear drives into the hearts of those. You know why? Because we don't truly believe what God said. When God says, I will be with you, I will never forsake you, He means that I will be with you always. I will never forsake you. That means during the pandemic, I will never forsake you. During the pandemic, I will protect you. During the pandemic, I'm going to be with you. I'm going to lift you up. I'm going to rise you up again. You see, listen, what's going to happen in our world one day is maybe that it's going to get worse than what it is now. Can y'all believe that? Do you think it'll ever get worse than what it is? If you don't believe that, you don't believe what the Bible says. It can get worse than what it is. But I want to tell you right now that there are children out there that have more faith than people in the church do. That there are children out there that believe this Word of God more than adults do. And I'm going to tell you right now, the Bible says that you must have faith as a child. You tell a child something, if they trust you enough, they'll believe it. You know what I'm saying? When God tells me something, I believe it. God says, I'll protect you, I'll trust you, and you don't have to worry about it. So what I want you to do now that you're back in church, and all of a sudden all that time that you've had, now you're back to worship again, I want you to understand this. Bring that smile back to your face. Amen. Bring that joy back to your heart. and understand that, hey, no matter what's going on, God's got me in the palm of his hand. Now listen to that real quick. God's got me in the palm of his hand. You get that? I don't even think a little lightning bug would feel secure in my hands. But God, his hands are a lot bigger than mine. He says, y'all about to be driving crazy about his heart. Give him a go to the mic, son. Which one do you have?
Nothing like technical difficulty, right? Now listen to me. I want you to know today, I've seen it. I've watched Christians. I've watched Christians panic. And I've watched them go into different places that they shouldn't go. And I hear your voices. And I can hear it. And I can feel it. I can feel the tension that was building before we started back church. You know what that is? It's Satan. And he's whispering in your ear. Be scared. And why God says, I'm not a God of fear. I'm not a God that's going to bring that fear in your lives. I'm going to bring comfort in your lives for those who trust him. I want you to know this today. Do you really believe in this God that we talk about? Do you really believe in it? Listen to me. I want to know that no matter what goes on in that world out there, be prepared. If it gets worse, I want you to be okay. Children, I'm not trying to scare you, but in fact, we got more children in the Sunday service than we've ever had since I've been here. That's okay. If you hear kids out there laughing or crying or whatever, get over it. Because they're going to be here, and we're glad that they're here. But here's the thing about it. Children, I'm going to talk to you for just a second. Because adults are already here. You know, children, you ain't got to worry about any of this. God's got you. And I want you to grow up strong and faithful. And I want you to say that, hey, whatever God's got in store for me, I can't wait for one of you young people to grow up and become a missionary and go to another country because you say God's got me. I can't wait for you to stand up in your schools when school starts back up and say, I love God and I trust God. You see, if not, you're going to grow up into a cowardly adult. And you know what? It's time to get rid of all that cowardness in our adult life. It's time to trust God. You with me today?
Amen.
I want us to learn to trust God with all that we've got. I want us to be proud that we are a child of God, that we love on other people, and then when the time comes to where we can meet together and we can start like we're doing now and places start opening up, you know what? Don't be the people in Walmart right now that are frowning all the time. I know you say you can't see their face anyway. You can tell when somebody's eyes get lifted a little bit there, right? And I feel like I've got the plague or something. I walk in Walmart and I'm watching people go, my bad. I mean, they are dodging me and I know y'all probably feel the same way. I feel like I'm the only one. Like, damn, what I got? You know what I mean? Wearing a mask and everything is still dodging me. I don't understand it. My point is this. Is the way that people are fearing you right now is the way that we're fearing everything else. I want you to look at Walmart, and that's what Christians look like today. We're scared of everything. I didn't tell you not to be cautious. You're wearing masks because we're being cautious. You're 6 feet apart because you're being cautious. But I'm just telling you right now, my God is bigger than any disease out there. My God will triumph over this. And we're going to get through it. And if there's fear in your hearts today, get rid of it. It doesn't belong. Can you trust in God that much to throw up your hands and say, God, you got me no matter what. You got me no matter what, and I'm going to trust in you. I want you to bow your heads for me. And I want anybody that's out there, the great thing about it is to be able to spread the gospel to anybody that's listening on Facebook Live. And I want you to know that if you're not here in the audience, but you're on Facebook Live, I want you to know this counts for you too. If we've been out there and we've been panicking, and you've been panicking and you haven't really gave your faith over to God, I want you to do it now. We don't really have a makeshift altar, and we'll probably have to stay away from that for right now. But I want you to know, if anybody wants to stand up and pray where you're at right now, if anybody wants to bow down and get on your knees on, I don't care what you want to do. If you want to make your altar, you can do it. But my point is this, when you get to a point and a place to say that, you know what, I'm fully ashamed of the way I've been living. And this don't have to be just fear. I'm fully ashamed of the sin that's in my life and the way that things have been going. And I want to change this. I want to change this right now. And if you don't know this Jesus that I'm talking about, man, this God that we serve is outstanding. This God is great. And this God right here will do mighty and wonderful things. And I want you to know right now, if you haven't put your trust in God, do it now. Do it now. If you're out there and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this is what I'll do. I'll get down on my knees with you. And if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, here's what you can do. You can pray this prayer with me. Say, dear God, I know that I'm a sinner and I have messed up in many ways. I ask that you come into my life and that you forgive me of my sins. I believe that you died on the cross for these sins that I've committed. And I ask that you forgive me of them today. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, it's going to be a little different. Altar calls and everything like that. Until things come up a little farther and we know what to do, we're going to still try to keep the regulations. But if you want to meet with me afterwards, I'll be good to meet with you. Okay? If you got to do business with God, you know, do business with God, whatever it takes. But I'm telling you right now, the most important relationship you'll ever have in your life, and I'm talking about people that's been in church all their life, maybe don't know that security of Jesus Christ. I know it. I believe it. I know He says who He is. What He says He is, who He says He is, and what He says He can do, I believe. You believe me today? You believe that today? Stand on the Word of God. Trust it. And believe that God can do some miraculous things in your life. So I want you to stand right now and worship with the praise band, if you will.
Come the faithful and weary soul, where all broken lives are in the Lord. As the hope betrayed, the crippled down, forever found.
Thank you.